This circuit can fold into a tiny rover, and surprise, it has no motors. Just kidding, we're going to use motors that are printed on a circuit. The first thing that pops into my mind when I think of robot rovers are four wheels connected to a box, where this box usually acts as a shell to protect the electronics and the motors. So what I'm going to try into here is like combine all these three things into one. This PCB motor already solved half of this problem. Its only drawback is the torque, especially because it needs to directly drive the wheels. But now I feel more confident using it after building this two-wheeled PCB motor robot. And the good news is that by adding two more wheels, we'll also be directly improving the driving torque. So I guess the remaining challenge is using the same circuit as a robust shell and fitting all the electronics inside. That's definitely a big headache. Circuits are usually made from two-dimensional copper boards like this. So we have to join multiple boards together to go into the third dimension. This can be easily done with connectors to make it modular, but I feel that for the specific robot, these will eat a lot of useful space and weight. So I think there's a better option, which is very similar to an unfolded cardboard box.
Obviously using a flexible PCB instead of cardboard.
Each side would have to fold 90 degrees to form a cuboid. So the sides can hold the four motors and you can put the rest of the electronics inside the middle piece. Copper is not going to like getting bended sharp like this. So we have to form like a little bridge for the tracks to pass through to soften their angle. Now the region where the electronics is going to sit has to be rigid, so I had a combination of steel and FR4 stiffeners on each side. The next challenge is going to be figuring out how to hold the whole thing together. We could add some taps with double-sided tape or solder pads, but both of these are permanent solutions. Remember that I also have to make the robot easy to open up for debugging. The motor already has a hole for the bolted shaft, so I think I'm going to use this to join everything together. To do that, I created these four tabs. That's fold behind the motor, and by using a nut I could sandwich everything together. I decided to name this robot Simplebot, or S-Bot for short. We'll talk about the robot circuit later on in the video, but for now I just have to give hats off to Altium Designer for pulling off this 3D visualization. I cannot even imagine making a project like this one without the tools that they provide. So if you'd like to take this CAD software for a spin, make sure you check out the link in my description where you can download a free trial of both Altium Designer and Altium 365.
Seems that the folding is going to work.
It looked way bigger on screen.
So let's open this thing up and start soldering it.
A problem. These top-sided stiffeners are going to create a large gap between the stencil and the actual PCB. So it kind of cannot be soldered using a stencil. I'm just going to cut it with scissors. And just like that, I had an assembled PCB. Let's take a moment to explain how the electronics is going to work. Each motor has a speed controller, which consists of a three-phase driver, a PIC16F microcontroller, and a Hall effect sensor. From the sensor, the controller can read the speed of the wheels and regulate the motor's commutation frequency based on the desired speed it receives from the ESP32. This module will be connected to a PlayStation joystick via Bluetooth, and it will use Wi-Fi for over-the-air programming. This ESP32 will also handle the onboard LiPo battery, the charger, proximity sensor, and inertial measurement unit. It also lights up these four LEDs. We have a little problem because only two LEDs are lighting up. I connected these LEDs to the nearest pin available without checking if they can be used as outputs. In fact, these specific two pins are used to communicate with the external flash chip on board the module, so using them as outputs is definitely a no-go. It took me a while to realize, but the ESP32 was not operating correctly, and sometimes not even reprogramming. The issue got resolved by just disconnecting the resistors from the pin.
Okay, so the next problem I'm trying to solve is flashing these PIC16F microcontrollers. I'm just testing 2 out of 4, but the problem is that one of them is flashing okay, while the other one is not. And I cannot find why.
Funny thing is that when heating it up, it is working, so I guess this has to do with a soldering issue.
To simplify the design, I shared the clock and data programming pins of all the 4 microcontrollers. Each device still had a reset so that each controller can be flashed with a unique software. And this worked pretty well on a breadboard, but for some reason it didn't work on my PCB. This made the motor's driver impossible to debug, because each one had to be desoldered on another PCB for it to be reflashed, so I figured that it was easier to just start over. Enter Mark II. Thank you, Bisbway, for being an awesome sponsor and remanufacturing my design. As you can see with this new version, I replaced both the steel and the FR4 stiffeners with aluminium, which also acted as a free heatsink for the motors. I also fixed the stencil. Well, sort of fixed, as it was still a bit annoying to squeegee the solder paste, but at least I didn't have to cut it this time. Each motor driver now has a unique set of programming pins. To fit everything, I had to remove the silkscreen designators. But with this change, I also managed to upgrade the 2 bulk electrolytic capacitors to 33 microfarads. I also rerouted the LEDs. Debugging was now pretty straightforward since I had already written most of the code. I just had to tune the motor speed controllers to work with the joystick. The rotors I'm using are made from an aluminium housing that holds an iron backplate and 8 arc magnets. The tires could be directly mounted to the rotor as they were 3D printed with flexible TPU. To make the robot more robust, I found these standoffs that could be screwed directly from side to side. The plan was to use this 1 cell 200mAh LiPo battery, but this was not fitting well with the new electrolytic capacitor and the standoff's limited height, so for the first test I decided to replace the standoffs with nuts. I also had to make some changes with the top side locking mechanism. Previously this was going to have a magnet to attract to the steel stiffener at the back, but for this new aluminium version I decided to use a solderable nut. This had some extra material at the back which didn't quite fit, so I had to cut it off. In this new PCB, I also included these small extra tabs that could close off the top side gaps. The banded bridges were a little sharper than intended, but the copper passing inside didn't show any sign of breakage. The robot did manage to move, but it was getting stuck very easily. At first I thought that the battery was clipping the current, but this was not the case. This thing should have a current discharge of around 4 to 10 amps. Then I found the problem. This robot sucks compared to my two-wheeled robot. This was very strange because it used the same exact PCB stator design, but the phase resistance was almost twice as much. I talked to Pisbway about this and they confirmed that for 4-layer flexible PCBs, the 2 inner layers cannot be manufactured with the same 1 ounce copper thickness. This is related to the pressure needed to hold the tin adhesive during manufacturing. So constant copper thickness can only be achieved with flexi-rigid technology for 4-layer flexible PCBs. But I think there's a solution to our problem, because if connect 2 batteries in series, you can roughly drive the motor with the same power, increasing the voltage instead of the current. But before we do this, I like to understand how the robot mechanics can be improved, because I'm sure this is not helping. I started by installing one of the standoffs at the back. I had to tilt the battery a little bit for it to fit, but this made the backside more rigid. The robot also performed a little bit better, but when encountering uneven surfaces, some of the wheels were slipping and rotating in the air, with the rest of the wheels unable to move. The robot is very lightweight, so I decided to modify the speed controller for the motors to drive slower and in open loop. I think the closed loop controller I had running was not helping, because some of the motors were still trying to catch up with others. So by driving all the motors in open loop, they are all forced to run at the same frequency. At this point, I also decided to try out different tires. While their wheels would increase traction, but the motors wouldn't spin them, I guess they were just too heavy.
Okay, so I did manage to get it to run on a fully charged battery. It seems that I spoke too soon.
These other spike tires really made a difference, because it was easier to climb over obstacles. But the robot was still struggling to go on uneven terrain, especially when the battery started running out. Turning left and right was also impossible. The cuboid was a little skewed and the motor sides were also slightly bent from the top side. After taking a closer look, I noticed that the small tabs at the top were putting quite a force on the sides. So I decided to remove these, and this made a huge difference.
That already looks so much better.
The robot also managed to lift this small camera. As cool as this looks, pavements or roads were still a no-go, even when oiling the bearings and adding a second standoff for extra support. So I guess it's time to upgrade to a 2-cell LiPo battery. Before powering the robot, I had to remove the onboard battery charger chip, as it could only handle 1 cell. The motors reached the maximum temperature the PCB can withstand at 7.2 volts. So it did exceed it at 8.2 volts, which is the maximum voltage the batteries get charged at. So we'll be overpowering the motors a little bit for a short period of time, but I think it can still handle it. Going left and right was a little bit slow, but I was still impressed, because going straight it managed to do the distance of my whole workshop. Now, how well does it handle the outdoor terrain? It definitely got stuck in some of the obstacles, but it also handled some of them very well considering its size. And that is all the testing I have made for this video. If you enjoyed watching it, please leave a like, and do leave your suggestions in the comments below, because I am planning to make a new version of this thing. If you want to learn more about PCB motors, check out these other two videos. And to end this, I would like to say a huge thank you to all my Patreons for supporting this project. Check out the link in the video's description if you'd like to join.